Looking back at your 45 years old long exceptional career, like I'd like to break it down into three different parts, like maybe 15-year span, and know a bit more about what was your structural engineering philosophy during these different phases, and how did it change over the years for you?
Okay, great. It was like with many people, a personal journey with some experiments and evolution. But I would say in the first 15 years, so this would have been about from 1975 to 1990, it was
Yes.
really a period of exploration and learning and growth. I started right out of school as a structural design engineer working on mostly buildings. I had a chance to work on some great projects, the geodesic sphere at Walt Disney World Epcot Center, Spaceship
Yes.
Earth, was one of my early projects. I got exposed to international work. We were working on a big hospital complex in Karachi, but
Okay.
also worked in some more traditional university buildings. So I got to work on a lot of creative work, a lot of international work, large projects and small in the design area. In
Okay.
1981, so that was still, in roughly the first third of that period,
Yes.
the walkways collapsed at the Hyatt Regency Kansas City, that famous and tragic
Yeah.
accident that killed a number of people. And the firm I was working for, Simpson Gumbertson Hager, was called to do a forensic investigation of that failure. And
Okay.
my boss at the time, who was Howard Simpson, the Simpson of Simpson Gumbertson Hager, was called to work on that, and he asked me to assist him. So I worked
Okay.
for a few years investigating the Hyatt Regency failure with him. And that really was a pivotal experience for me, because reflecting on that failure and the tragedy of the loss,
Yes.
and walking through the process of what went wrong to cause that tragedy, really had a profound impact on me in terms of giving me an appreciation for the responsibility that we all bear as structural
Yes.
engineers,
Yes.
and the opportunities there are, frankly, to have problems, and the importance of really executing your responsibility for the health, safety, and welfare of the public.
Yes.
So
Yes.
that got me a bit into forensic engineering practice-wise, but it also set me on an early path about how our industry learns from disasters like this and other failures, and how
Yes.
we continuously need to keep these problems in mind so we can improve practice and hopefully avert the repetition of tragedies like that.
Yes.
I also had in this period an opportunity to work in the engineering mechanics area. We had an
Okay.
engineering mechanics group at SGH, and
Okay.
I had learned finite element analysis from some of the best at Berkeley. Ray
Yeah.
Clough was generally considered to be the father of the finite element method.
Yes, yes.
I learned from him. And so I did a lot of finite element work in engineering mechanics. And worked on what we call their precision structures. These are structures like radar antennas and radio telescopes and high precision optical telescopes.
Okay.
Also along the line, had the opportunity to work on some building envelope work, so which
Okay.
hinges on architectural technology and gets into other aspects of building design than straight structures. And that was a good experience for me.
Okay.
But in terms of my philosophy about engineering, at each phase, I really took the opportunity to learn all that I could about
Okay.
whatever the subject matter was. I was
Yes.
curious. I worked in a lot of different areas, and I tried to make each project a learning experience where I would take books home, I would read journals, I would ask a lot of questions. And just ask myself continuously over the course of these projects, what more can I learn about this and delve deeper and really make
Okay.
myself a subject matter expert? So
Okay.
that was the first 15 years. The success of those first 15 years sort of spilled into the next 15. And I would say the theme there was mostly around increasing responsibility for the management and the leadership of the firms, and eventually in leadership at Simpson, Gumbridge & Hager. So I was made a principal of SGH around 1990.
Okay.
About 15 years into my experience there. There I had responsibility for managing client relationships, for business development, for leading teams, even leading small parts of the organization, and got involved in the leadership of larger and more complex projects.
Okay.
So I became CEO of the firm actually in 1995. Yes. It was time for Howard Simpson, who was our first CEO, turned the hat over to our next generation. And then the firm was about 120 people, and it was growing.
Yes.
But still, in the early days of my work as an engineering leader, I was able to work on technical projects still and balance that and combine it with my
leadership
roles.
Yes.
So that was good. The final 15 years was a continuation or an evolution, but Simpson, Gumbridge & Hager was growing. As I mentioned, the company was about 120 people when I took over. By the time I retired from that job near 2020, it was over 600 people. So there was a lot of growth going on.
Yes.
And so I was concentrating on growing the company. But as the firm grew, so did my job as CEO.
Yeah.
And I had to begin to do less technical work. I always did some. I was always committed to doing technical work. And our firm and our board of directors thought it was important for the company's leadership to be technical leaders as well.
Yeah.
But the amount of time I was able to devote to technical work started to diminish relative to the burdens of the CEO job.
Yes.
But in that period, I was really focusing on exploration and innovation and what it took to be a great company.
Okay.
I learned a lot about leadership and collaboration, and I took great satisfaction in identifying and growing the next generation of leaders in our company. So it was a very different experience than my first few years or even 15 years. And for the last part of this period, it was really important that we plan for the eventual generational transition or change in leadership at SGH, including my job as CEO. And so I was tasked with planning and organizing and then executing that plan for leadership transition because at 10 years prior to the transition, most of the leadership were from the baby boomer generation, and we knew we would be moving on, you know, over a period of time, and we wanted to prepare for that. So that leadership transition, which is successfully complete and behind us at Simpson, Gumbridge & Hager, took a period of about 10 years. So making sure that happened correctly was a big part of my responsibility for those last 15 years.